Good evening, Demon fans, and welcome back to the Demonland podcast. My name is Andy, and we've done it. We've clean swept the Marsh series and retained our undefeated preseason status. And now we're less than 2 weeks away from the 2020 season proper. And I, for one, am full of hope for what dreams may come. Joining me tonight is longtime Demonlander George. And George, I find myself in an unfamiliar position of optimism. How are you feeling on the eve of the season?
Well, all the talk this week, Andy, and welcome to everybody on the podcast tonight. All the talk this week has been about viruses, and I think the really big question this week is, have the clinical trials of a vaccine against MFCSS been successful? And has our own Andy been cured of the symptoms following the victories against Adelaide North and Hawthorn? And hopefully we'll find out at some time during the course of this podcast.
Well, as you heard, I am very optimistic. So, fingers crossed. I think so far so good. The clinical trials have been successful, but it's not until we get into the real deal, the real stuff, that we'll see where I am with that. I mean, it could all come crashing down after round one and two. And as you know, we've got a tough first two rounds to open up the season. So, I'm cautiously optimistic at the moment. I'm liking what I'm seeing. So if we can carry all of what I've seen into the season proper, I'll be very happy and we'll hopefully be cured. But nothing will cure my Melbourne Football Club supporter syndrome, as we know. Nothing will cure that except a premiership, so we might be still a little bit away from that.
Let's hope you've got some immunity for the first couple of rounds at least, so we'll have to wait and see.
Definitely, and our regular co-host Grave Viney may be joining us in about half an hour or so, but in the meantime, if you'd like to join us tonight to discuss any of the topics that we're talking about, you can give us a call on 03-9016-3666. That's 03-9016-3666, or you can Skype us at Demonland31. If you're listening to the show live, come join us in the chat room where you can ask questions or post comments. Just head over to demonland.com/podcast. If you're listening to this at your leisure via SoundCloud on demonland.com or via an Apple or Android podcasting app, be sure to subscribe to the podcast to receive updates when a new show drops. Don't forget to leave us a favorable review. It really does help people find us. We're also on Spotify, so you can get the show that way too. Just go to demonland.com to find the links to your preferred method of listening. You can also follow us on Facebook at facebook.com/demonland31, on Twitter at demonland, on Instagram at demonland31, or on YouTube, just search for Demonland Podcast and listen to some of the interviews that we've conducted with current and past players and coaches. If you love talking about the D's 24/7 all year round, just hop on over to demonland.com and you can chat with other D's fans from around the world about this great club. And now, with all that out of the way, George, I guess we can talk about what we liked, what we didn't like about the game on the weekend. For me, fitness, and in particular our ability to run out games, has been my biggest takeaway from the preseason. We've only had the two Marsh games and that one scratch match against oppositions to compare us, and admittedly, I don't believe that any of those teams will be pushing for top six action. Adelaide, I think, will be at the wrong end of the ladder in 2020. North had a skeleton team in, as we did, but they and the Hawks will probably be in the 7 to 12 range, I guess. I'm not sure if either of those teams will get higher. I guess, a good test of our fitness and abilities will be in the first two rounds against genuine front runners. But so far, the Darren Burgess-led fitness campaign looks to be paying dividends. You must be happy with what you've seen in that regard.
That's certainly the case, Andy. I think, and compared with last season, This is really a chalk and cheese scenario that last year we had players struggling to get on the field. Even the players that were on the field hadn't done proper pre-seasons. And now I think we're starting to see the real benefits of the arrival of Burgess. In all of the games that we've seen, we've really blown the sides away in that last quarter. Now it's only practice matches, and there's so many manoeuvres going on the field from the coaches. They are setting up scenarios that they're trialling out all the time, but certainly our players who are on the field seem to be running out the game fully. We did have a situation last year with the lack of pre-season done by the majority of the players that, you know, final quarters were our Achilles heel, and games that we were in at three-quarter time just evaporated in those last 20, 25 minutes of play. But it's only three games in, and it's looking very promising at the moment. The indications from the Hell and Back series, which I think we'll talk about later on as well, that they really have been putting in a lot of work and effort. And I think the players are seeing the results of that, which is also pleasing. They see the work that they've done producing the benefits. That can only build their confidence, and will hopefully do so during the season proper.
100%. We can lump, you know, a like and a dislike together, and they both involve the forward line structure. Again, we started off, I thought, just bombing it into our forward 50. I'd like to see some more structured, some of that lead up marking goal entries. Many times we just bombed it up to T-Mac, who either went in the wrong position or was three, you know, deep in a high marking contest. And now I'll back T-Mac one-on-one in a marking contest any day of the week, but it makes it hard if he has to contest in a pack of three players, which you know, might have been because Hawthorn sort of had a pretty tall, went in with quite a tall back line. Mm-hmm. But it really made it hard the way we were just bombing it in early on.
Yeah, it was really hard to judge because I only saw the match on the television. It's really hard to judge when you're looking on the TV what's actually going on the field. There's a couple of things I suspect might have been happening. Firstly, it being a practice match, they're trying different structures. Our first unfortunate scenario was that T-Mac and Weed, I don't think, played much together in the way of the forward line. Was that your recollection?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. So the second thing I think was that because Hawthorn were playing Stratton, Frawley, and Frost, you know, rather tall back line there, that T-Mac was actually running up the field a lot and dragging them out of the front of the forward line. I think that was why, between them, Fritsch and Melcham kicked nine goals.
Yeah.
Dragging those players up the field just left holes at the back one-on-one for those two very damaging players. So whether that was a deliberate action on the part of the coaches, if it was, it was fantastic. But I'd just as equally take on the comments that Gary Lyon made, I think, at one point during the game when Ed Langdon was running up the field and he was calling for the forwards to lead out to him. I thought that for the last couple of years they've been so unused to having someone that free and open and ability to deliver the ball into the forward line that they're just not used to leading anymore. I'm sure David Neitz would know how to do it, but perhaps the current crop don't know how to do it anymore. Hopefully we'll see that change, and hopefully we'll see a more established and consistent forward line in the terms of getting the bodies in there for a couple of weeks at a time to be able to work together and understand where they're going to be able to run and the patterns that they need to set up. So, but still, like I said, nine goals between Melcham and Fritsch, you can't complain about that, particularly Fritsch in those one-on-one situations is proving to be a nightmare for opposition players.
Yeah, and just to your point about that, you know, that leading up, you know, with Langdon screaming out for it, we've had the whole preseason without opposition to be able to practice those type of things. So you would have hoped that that leading, particularly because it was such a deficiency last year where we were just bombing it in, and partly because, you know, we didn't have, you know, Fritch wasn't down there, Melksham was injured, yep. You know, T-Mac, you know, later in the year was injured, he was out of form for the first part of the year, so, you know, well, look, we've had the whole summer to work on that, but, you know, as you mentioned, the good thing about our forward line this year as opposed to last year is that we have those players like Bailey Fritch back in his rightful position. How he ever played in defence, I do not know. I mean, I was screaming about it. I understand they like to play players back, and you know he's got such a beautiful kick, and they probably thought he'd be a great distributor off half back, but he is a natural forward, and you know he can play on the talls, he can play on the shorts. It's very hard to sort of match up on him. You know, you've got a fit Melksham back in the team, and he's always going to worry oppositions. I'm not going to worry too much about T-Mac taking on three players if Melksham and Fritch are going to combine for those nine goals, as you said. You know, both are seriously classy footballers, and, you know, they're going to command, both of them will command decent opposition. Frawley was moved on to Fritch, you know, later into the game, and that was because, you know, Max was rested, Weed went into the ruck, so we had one tall short. We didn't, if we'd had Weed and T-Mac there, I don't think Hawthorn would have had the luxury to sort of put a Frawley onto Fritch, even though he probably commanded one of their best player. And then even if they do put Frawley onto Fritch, then you got Weed sort of on playing on who, you know. They had a young sort of, you know, first gamer, or only played a couple of games out there. So, yeah, Fritch is going to command a decent player, but then if, you know, we're going to worry oppositions with who they manned up on which, you know, providing we've got all these guys in there. And I guess we can talk about tall forwards and what we're going to do going into round one. You know, we rested Brown, who kicked three goals in Marsh one, and then you were at the scratch match that I was at. He kicked five behinds in that scratch match. Now, I was impressed with Brown. He only kicked 5 points, but he gets the ball. He can take a mark. He presents well. He's also going to command a decent backman because he's got that height and he can take a mark, so you can't just put anyone on him. You've got to sort of match up on him. That could have easily, his 5 points could have easily been 3 goals, 4 goals, 5 goals. So, you know, now we've got Weed, who is under an injury cloud. Have we heard anything about our injuries? I'll talk about them more later. But
I haven't heard anything.
No.
It looked like a pretty good ankle twist, but the good thing is that if, you know, those sort of things probably are only 2 weeks short of doing any ligament damage. If he's done any ligament damage, then he won't be playing round one. But we haven't
heard.
I haven't heard anything.
No, so we don't know the severity of that injury. So we're just waiting on confirmation as of this time of this podcast of how bad that ankle injury might be. Didn't look good, but it did look like just a roll. But who knows? It's with these things. It's funny, but you know, we haven't had much of an opportunity to see the Weed play in his natural position as a key forward, as he's had to play ruck all day in Marsh 1 and then for the second half in Marsh 2. It's, you know, and I think it's going to be the story this year. Weed's going to have to sort of only play half his time, or not half, probably more than half, because he'll only probably have to play 5-7 minutes a quarter in the ruck, but it seems like we're going to go with the Weed Gorn combination for the moment, perhaps once Jackson
develops. That certainly looks to be the case. In the three games, they've only tried Jackson for short periods of time, and you know, quite honestly, I don't think he's got the body yet to be able to play in that role for any period of time, even as a second ruck. Wiedemann is, you know, those 2 or 3 years better developed body-wise. So, and the fact that they've continuously opted to play Wiedemann in that secondary ruck role, although he has had to play far more extensive periods than what perhaps the coaching panel would like, given Gawn's absence over the last couple of weeks. I think it's going to be the Gawn as number one and Wiedemann as the number two. The real pity for Wiedemann is during this period of time, he hasn't really had that chance to work alongside T-Mac and work alongside Fritsch and the other forwards. But it'll be interesting to see what they come up with in the first round. I agree with you on Brown. He's just that player who, probably the same at Essendon, he just turns up every week and gets a goal or two here or there. Hopefully he can improve his percentages in front of goal from what we saw at the North Melbourne game. But I suspect that Brown might well get a Guernsey for a start off, just simply because he can sit up there and take that second defender. Fritsch is very good, but you don't want to be coming up against, as we are against West Coast, where you've got Hearn, McGovern and Barras, who will take people apart very quickly if they haven't got the right body, since they're all such big, strong players. So I wouldn't be surprised to see Brown in there as well at the first match.
Given Weed, if he's not injured, if he's right to go, do we go in? How does our forward line stack up? Obviously, T-Mac's in there, obviously, Fritsch and Melksham. Weed, if he's right, plays as the backup to Max. Does Brown get in, or does Brown...
I think that's the $64 question for us at the moment, isn't it? Brown hasn't been tried as a ruck. I thought they might have tried out Tomlinson at some stage as a ruck. They haven't done that.
Yep. They didn't even play Brown as a ruck in that North Melbourne game, because who do we have? We had Bradkey as ruck, and then they had that guy from Casey in the ruck as well. So they didn't even try Brown that. So obviously that's not something they're looking at doing.
Yeah. Look, I think it's a nice problem to have in one respect, that, you know, at least this year we've got players to be able to put into the slots. The bigger problem is when you start adding...
Ooh, looks like...
You run, say, Wiedemann, T-Mac and Brown, and you've got Fritsch and Melksham, you see you're left with one spot. Well, who goes?
Yeah.
Who stays?
Good problem to have. Last year, many times, and I guess any team that's got a lot of injuries, you don't have those problems. But this problem is a good problem to have, and hopefully the coaching staff can get the mix right. And obviously, week to week, depending on who you're playing, it's going to change from week to week, and it's a good thing, you know. And if they can get the mix right, that's very good. Perhaps we'll move on to small forwards. Cozzy didn't play for personal reasons. I think he went back home. He had a funeral. What did you make of Bedford's game and Spargo's games? I'll follow up that with what we think will get a round one call up.
I think this is going to be the $64,000 question, as it used to be known. We've got I think either of those players could fit in. We have to wait and see on Cozzy whether he's back and up and running. I would love to see him in there. I'm sure most Melbourne supporters, even if you haven't seen him at training, he is something to behold when he gets onto the ground. However, I think Spargo is putting in the hard yards and is probably a safer bet, for want of a better word, at this stage to go in. Cozzy will have plenty of opportunity during the season. So we can only wait and see on that, but you can't complain about anything that Spargo was doing, certainly in those last two games. He just seems to be in the right place when the ball drops and just seems to be out there, out the back, and gets those handballs away. He struggles to kick long distances, of course, but gee, for a small forward, he's not doing anything wrong at the moment. So I suspect we'll see him. The next question is, does Bedford get a run? He looked pretty impressive as well in the short period of time I think he was on the ground. But again, I think he will get his opportunity as the season progresses, more so than in the first round. But once again, isn't it nice that we've got an option of effectively three small forwards in there to fill one hole? At the moment, I simply can't see maybe two holes if Brown doesn't get a Guernsey. But again, it's a nice position to be in, three into two, as opposed to last year where we were just struggling to put anybody into the hole. So,
yeah.
What are your thoughts?
My thoughts, I'd love to see Cozzy get a game first up. I'm not sure whether they'll do it. It's a game in Western Australia, you know. I'd love for him to get a game. I think he probably puts more scoreboard pressure on, can find the goals more so than Spargo. I was impressed with Spargo in the scratch match game, and you know, he did some nice little things in the game against Hawthorn. I think you can only go with one of them, because obviously Neil Bullen's going to be in there as the other sort of small forward playing more for the further up the ground. I'd like to see Cozzy, but then I think Spargo probably just is outdoing Bedford at the moment. I don't know. That's a tough one. Good problem to have.
Yeah. The other possibility that we might see is that we've got the numbers on the bench as well. So whether you have an A and B Spargo Cozzy combination rotating through the bench, because A and B will run in through the middle at some stage or another. Even though there might be only one position effectively on that forward line, you might be able to rotate through that and the bench in the same way that I think they're using Harms, Jones, and the half back line. But we can only wait and see what the coaching staff want to do, and it depends on what their assessment is of who's in the best position at this time. I would have loved to have seen Cozzy against Hawthorn. That would have given us a fairly good idea, more so than perhaps the North Melbourne seconds game, where he once again gets very, very close to doing something very, very spectacular, but isn't quite there yet. When he does, he will be something to really excite the crowds. So it's a bit of an unknown at the moment. We just got to wait and see until about 10 days' time.
That's right. Gorney made a successful comeback from his knee injury. He looked a little bit slow, I thought, at the start. Yeah. I was a bit worried, because I thought that he was sort of limping a bit, but I think he just took a little bit of time to get into the game. But for me, he did enough. He did enough for me to be happy that he'll be firing on all cylinders come round one. He's still got, under 2 weeks now to come back right. But, he'll be fit and firing then. I guess the question is, we sort of mentioned it a bit when we were talking about Weed. We've seen Jackson sort of play bit parts. He had to play a bit of the end of the game in the ruck and sort of, you mentioned his body, it probably isn't up to it, and that's not a knock on him. Ideally you'd like to see him develop in the twos, because we've only seen glimpses. I think he had like 12 hit-outs, and if you compare that to what Gorney had for the first half, he had 14 hit-outs. So obviously he doesn't do what Gorney does around the ground. But I saw some glimpses of the things I liked. There were one or two times where sort of he competed in the ruck contest and then sort of followed it up, with a bit of roving himself, which I saw Nick Knack do on the weekend, and you see Brody Grundy do that, and that'll click for him, and I think that'll be the type of ruckman he is. So there's a lot to look forward to. He sort of got bodied out of the way and pushed a little bit sometimes, I thought illegally, by Segler. It's good experience for a kid like that to get in the preseason, play against a big bodied ruckman and see what it's all about.
Yeah, and that's exactly what it was about. I think it gave us a realistic view if we start to play him in the ruck. I still hold the opinion that he may well finish up as a tall midfielder in the same way that Cripps is. Segler's obviously going to be Hawthorn's number one ruck this year. They've dropped McAvoy down back line. McAvoy, although this was his first game back from injury, looked very, very out of it in a big way. So Segler's going to be the main ruckman for them. And he really did push Jackson around, whereas when Gawn was up against Gawn, Gawn really buried him in a big, big way. And then you saw the sharp contrast with the new young rookie on it, and Segler really, like you said before, pushed him around, not unexpectedly, but that's the difference between the two. There's a long way to go for Jackson, and this is all part of the learning process. He'll be something to watch, but this was a practice match effectively, and that's why you give them the chance to go up against a seriously good ruckman. He may well get more chance down at Casey to show his wares, but he now knows what the standard is that he's expected to play once he makes that step up to the seniors, which will occur at some stage very, very soon, I think.
Yeah, and I think when Max went off, they started to get on top in the midfield, in the ruck in the midfield, and it took us a while to sort of adapt to that. And once we sort of did adapt, and that's a good thing, I think, that we were able to sort of, they were getting on top of us, and our midfielders were able to adjust to not getting the silver service from Max, and to work off another ruckman. So that was pleasing to see, because we did get back into the game after that.
Particularly, as you said, last year in that scenario, if Max was off the ground, the opposition just ripped us apart quite often, because we only had Wiedemann, or we were throwing T-Mac into the ruck. If they came up against someone like a Grundy or one of the bigger bodies, the Goldsteins, it was once again really like chalk and cheese. But this year, the mids really read it well when Segler was getting on top. Hawthorn didn't break away in any way, shape or form. It became a real knock them down, drag them out, grinding sort of game, which normally the opposition can get away with, particularly Hawthorn, but they didn't this time. So that was pleasing for the mids as well.
And speaking of our mids, they're just purring at the moment. In the first game, it was Petrarca. This week, it was Viney, 33 possessions, 5 bone-crunching tackles. The goal was a beautiful goal. It's going to be hard for opposition teams to target any one of our midfielders, because if they take out Clary, then Petrarca steps up, or Viney does, then there's Brayshaw, or you can chuck Harms sort of back into the middle, or Jonesy, he's not done yet. He can play a couple of midfield minutes here or there. It's going to be, in the past sort of, an opposition would take out one of our midfielders and that would be it, but we've got more than one string in the bow there, and it's great to see.
Yeah, and Hawthorn's midfield with O'Mara, Mitchell and Warple at the moment, they're a pretty serious combination. It'll be interesting when we come up against the West Coast people, but I think our mids really ground them. It took them half the game to get to that point. Just a good old-fashioned hard game of football. But, when you've got the Vineys and Brayshaws and Jones and Harms just continuously going in hard, it was right back to the best of 2018 for us. With that combination, it's nice to have them all in there again. Let's hope that continues for quite some time. The coaches have created other options, particularly with Jones and Harms, the ability to play them off the half back line, but where they can still be quite devastating to the opposition when they slide forward and kick a goal here or there, or they get thrown into the middle to shut down someone like a Mitchell, which I think they were doing at times as well. So the coaches must be very, very pleased having those sorts of options available to them with, 4 or 5 players in really good form. So it's very nice position for them to be.
So where is Jones? It's hard for me to tell watching on TV where exactly he's lining up, where he's positioned, because he seems to be sort of a bit everywhere. He seems to be a bit off half back. I notice him in the forward line or off half forward flank, and I like him sort of there. But, is he playing that sort of sweeping role off half back? Because it's hard for me to tell.
I think it's more he's coming off the bench as an impact type player.
Yep.
There's that Harms they seem to have slotted into one of the half back flank positions as such, but again I think that's as a it creates another option for rotation. But Jones I think is coming more off the bench and just filling any role associated with the midfield. You know, so he can go in and do the in and unders if needs be. He can float behind the ball, and we've seen him come sliding forward a couple of times in previous games, and just nobody seems to be on him at the moment. Just you know, snagging those goals nicely from the 50-metre line and things like that. So I think his role is going to be on and off the bench more as an impact-type player. I've been really impressed with Harms. You know, I thought he might struggle to adopt the halfback type of role, but he's just swings between one and the other. His development the last couple of years has been just phenomenal to see him just take on these various roles. I don't think people thought he was a tagger 2 years ago, but all of a sudden he's probably one of the best that we've got. And now he's filling a role in the halfback line as well. So very versatile player, and he just keeps getting the ball and just hard and tough and gets up and goes to the next contest and the next one after that. That seems to be the modus operandi. So very pleased with what I'm seeing at the moment.
So the versatility, I think, is the main thing there, because I thought he had a great second half, but they had sort of moved him sort of onto the ball or up forward even a little bit. So it's that versatility he can, you know, and just however the flow of the game is, I think, you know, we can move him if it's not working off half back or we need him in another position, whether it is to go on ball to tag someone or drift forward, he can do that. And that versatility is another string in his bow as well to his game. So, yeah, really like that, Harms, and I'm happy that the club, the footy department, is, you know, making moves like that. It's good to see, and we, you know, we obviously have the cattle on the field to be able to have that flexibility to do that.
The other beauty about Harms is that when he goes to one of those other roles, it's not a step down. Like, you know, if we've got Weed in the ruck or T-Mac in the ruck, it's obviously a step down from the first option being Mac. But when Harms goes into the middle, we don't lose anything. Harms plays off the half back line, we don't lose anything. It's a great option to have. You know, he's just that player who just plays any role, any time, anywhere. So that's fantastic for him as a player. I think it's a great credit to the people who've developed him into those various roles.
Defensively, we've been very solid over the preseason. We've only conceded 16 goals in the two games. Stephen May and Jake Lever, they rarely played together in the same team last year, and we're going to see Lever at his best with May around, so that Lever can play that intercepting defender role. May is a beast. It was great to be able to see, you know, have a player like him be able to go and play on Patton. And I don't think Patton was at his best. I don't know if he's injured or whether he's just soft. He seemed to float like a marshmallow.
He looked very unfit to me. When I remember one of the close-ups on the television, and this was in the first quarter, he had sweat beads running down his face. He looked completely spent. Mind you, I'd be spent if I had to spend my time on Stephen May for 25 minutes. But, I don't think Patton's going to be the great white hope that he might be, but still, Hawthorn picked him up for nothing. Good luck to them.
But just having May, you know, he's a monster to, you know, have a guy like that who does have, also has some good skills, and that kick that he kicked into the middle, hit Maxi on the chest, was just absolutely sublime.
That was an absolute ripper, wasn't it? That's to have someone who can do that, and I think when Salem comes back in, it's going to be even more lethal, because the opposition at a point kick in won't know where to go. If they set their zone up close to the goals, May will can go over the top of them, very like he did in that scenario. throws the ball to Salem, and Salem will put a kick through right through the middle of them to someone else. It's going to really throw spanner in the works for opposition coaches and the defenders with this pair bringing the ball back into play. But wasn't that a magnificent series of, you know, May to Gawn to Langdon to Fritsch? And it was just fantastic to watch. Fantastic.
That play was my favourite play of the night. I actually would have liked Langdon to run it in and have a ping at goal. He was unselfish, gave it off to Fritsch, but it'd be nice to have seen him have a ping at goal. And we'll talk about our wingman a little bit later on because we're still talking about the backman. There were some mixed feelings about Hibbert in the game day and post-game threads on Demonland. I've been mixed on him at times. There's, you know, you've got a whole range of opinions on him from people saying that he's well past his All-Australian form, he's done, to people thinking the exact opposite, that, he was named in the best by on AFL.com. How much stock you can put in that, I don't know. where are your thoughts on Hibbert and his future in the team?
It'll be interesting with Hibbert. I think the big his problem is his kicking delivery, but also his greatest asset is his kicking, and particularly for last year, he can get the ball. He's strong, can get the ball and kick it 50 metres away from the defensive circles, which has been beneficial. Gets the ball away from the opposition goals, and sometimes that's just exactly what you need. Just get it out of there any way you can, put it on the boot, stop the attack. The difficulty is now that we've got a more established, you know, we've got the players back like May, we've got Jetta back, we've got Salem on the other flank, we've got Lever probably playing the traditional centre-half back type position, and where do you put Harms? If Harms is rotating off the half back line, where do you put Jones if he's rotating off the half back line? Where do you put Hibbert? Again, it's a nice problem for the coaches. Hibbert's, you know, obviously aging like a lot of the players are, and his best might be behind him. I think he's got still a very useful role to be able to play. And I think we might see the coaches selecting on the basis of who we're playing against, but at the moment he's sort of on the margins with the pressure coming from those other two players, and he might be part of that rotation, Harms, Hibbert, Jones off the bench, half back line type of thing that I was talking about with the forward line problem that we've got with, you know, Cozzy and Spargo and say an A and B or someone like that. So nice problem to have again. We'll find out during the season. You know, injuries will occur, and it's nice to have those type of players available to us. I think this was the first game that we actually had, apart from Salem, I think this is the first time that May, Lever, Jetta and Hibbert have all been able to play together in the two seasons that certainly May's been at the club. So they seem to gel pretty well. They held Hawthorn to, was it six goals or something?
Yep.
Which is a pretty damn good effort. Hawthorn had great hopes for Patton, but I think they might have realised that they actually haven't got too many other players. Their goals were coming from free kicks in front of, you know, when people were being tackled in front of goal, but there wasn't too much else that was threatening to us for the Hawthorn forward line. Pioppolo was unsighted. Jetta did a complete blanketing job on him. So I think the Hawks might struggle to actually get some score on the board. Bruce did nothing. They didn't have Gunston, but I think Gunston might be past his best as well. So pleased that we were on the field and they're not.
And Burgoyne as well didn't do much either.
No. Nothing at all, yeah.
One player you didn't mention when you were talking about our back line is a defender that, for me, has probably I think maybe you've secured a spot in the team, and that's Jay Lockhart. I really like the way he goes about it. He can run and carry the ball. He has poise. He's not afraid to take a player on, which is good for a young kid. Like, I think there was one time he did get caught trying to do too much. But, you know, I just love it. He's hard at it. Yeah, he loves a tackle. He's good in the air, and he's good on the ground. Has he secured a spot in the team? I know it's part of that great problem that we have at the moment. Does he get squeezed out? I mean, we've got Salem coming back in.
That might be more the problem. I really love Lockhart as well. Even when he came in, I think three quarters of the way through last season, he's just one of those natural footballers. You know, he knows, and that I think comes from his experience at Casey and before. He just knows where the ball's going to be and what he's got to do to get the ball and do the right thing. It's going to be very difficult, finding a slot for him. But I wouldn't be surprised at all. He doesn't do too much wrong when he's on the field. There's certainly a couple of other players who get a run every week who I'd have my heart in my mouth more than what I would if Jay Lockhart had the ball in his area. It'll be nice if he gets a run. This is all about the development of those type of players as well. You picked up a couple of games last year. You'll get a few more this year, and maybe we won't see the best from him until next year. You know, gets 20 and 25 and 30 games under his belt until we see the best. But at the moment, again, he's a very, very nice option to have sitting available, and he may well get that run in the first game.
And this is the first year that he's had a full preseason under his belt, coming from obscurity last year. So, it's only can benefit him, and he'll be there.
There's a lot of similarities between him and Fritsch, isn't there? Came into the game, didn't get the full preseason, showed more than enough in the first season to keep him there, and then poor old Fritchie got stymied by the fact that half the team wasn't available last year and was played all over the place. But come year three, he's showing his best, and I think Lockhart might be the same. Those natural footballers that you just love to watch in action.
And I've saved the best to last, the wingman. Tomlinson and Langdon, they had 57 possessions between them, 32 and 25 respectively. 18 marks between them, 10 and 8 respectively. Both of them ran all night and presented targets and dominated their opponents who aren't inexperienced players themselves. Scully, Smith. Neither of those are crap players. So I think it's an absolute, they've just added, so that outside running capacity that adds an element of attacking capacity to our team, where it's been previously missing, and they create that barrier around the edges where the ball all too often slipped through the cracks, allowing easy opposition goals. We saw that in quite a few times on the footy shows last year. If things continue to work as they did the other night, the draft, the bringing in of these two guys, that have these elite running skills, could be regarded as a recruiting coup. Just amazing. It was exactly what the doctor ordered from what we saw last year and in previous years, and we're reaping the reward so far.
Isn't it such a sharp contrast and such a credit to the recruiting people? Last year, I think we tried 16 people on the wing position. We did have the injuries problems, but we still tried 16 people, and I don't think they found anybody who was suitable to run through there. The coaching staff and the recruiting staff decided we needed to get a couple of wingers. Well, we've picked up two absolute rippers by the looks of it, and the just completely changes the way that the team operates when you've got two guys getting nearly 60 possessions in a game of football down each wing, and Langdon's run is just elite, and Tomlinson's height and marking ability as well. Just threatens the opposition so much, particularly when it's coming out of their back line, that they look down the line and they see someone who's 6 to 8 centimetres tall, they're not going to kick it that way. And it just ruins their defensive structures. I think Frawley a couple of times during the game just didn't know where to kick the ball. It was just going to come straight back, and it did. So these two, and then when Langdon gets his hands on the ball on the wing free, it's for the first time I think those forwards' eyes must be lighting up, going, here it comes, it's coming my way, and it certainly does. So yeah, credits to everybody, the recruiting staff, the coaching staff, for identifying the problems and going out and actually filling those needs so very, very well. They really look fantastic. Tomlinson, to have, I think he's played 120 games at GWS. So while he was out of action for probably a month or so during the pre-season, I think he importantly had that that basic fitness level all sewn up. So when he's come back really strong. He didn't is not like a first or a second year kid who needs 6 to 8 weeks to even get remotely close to being able to play seniors. He was straight back into it, and producing those sort of results is just fantastic. Let's hope it continues during the year.
And we're joined by co-host Grabe Viney. Grabe Viney, how are you going?
Excellent. Thanks, Andy. Good evening, George, and to all the Demon Landers out there. I know we're coming to the closing end of the podcast, but I thought I'd better get my 2 cents in, both on the wingers. And I'm worried, of course, that the Demon Land podcast is going to be shut down by the coronavirus soon. So I thought I'd better get my last statements on air before that happens.
Well, the good thing about a podcast is that that's probably the only way we'll get to talk to each other in the coming weeks and months. And we'll talk about coronavirus and whether we're going to get to watch any footy this year a bit later. Grabe Viney, you might want to start. We were just talking about our wingmen. Anything to add about these guys?
No, look, George summed it up well. I've got to put my hand up. I was a little bit ambivalent about the recruiting of Tomlinson. I hadn't seen a whole lot of him play, but thought it might be a bit of a vanilla selection. But if what we saw the other night is a window into what we're going to see for the rest of the year, then, I'm pretty excited, I've got to say. Everything we're looking for and more from both him and Langdon at the moment.
Just adding to what George said about having them on the wings, and you got a guy who can mark like Tomlinson on one side of the ground when you got the kickouts, and you got Gorn on the other side. It's sort of good options for our kickouts to be able to have on either side of the ground two guys that can take a mark. Which we sort of haven't had. For a while, Grabe Viney, we've talked about most of the game. Tall forwards, I'll quick fire questions to you. tall forwards, who do we go? Providing Weed is injury free for round one, do we dare to go against West Coast with 3 tall forwards? Or we just go with the we were saying Weed's got a bit, probably has to be in if he's fit because he's been doing the ruck work. Brown hasn't, but do we consider Brown as a third tall?
Yep, I think so, particularly if it's going to be a dry deck there, and you'd imagine it would be. And I think as impressed as I've been from the little glimpses that we've seen of LJ in the pre-season so far, I'd be going with the 3 more mature players, Weed, Brown and McDonald, if 3 indeed is the way to go. Why didn't Brown play on Friday night?
Perhaps because he played in that scratch match. Loads, I don't know. They knew Gorn.
Yeah, just wondering whether it's a guide to what the thinking is. But
maybe perhaps he's not in contention for round one. I would have thought maybe considering that they knew Max was only going to play half a game and that Weed was going to come out of the forward line, why not play him? Don't know. Good question. Maybe that answers.
I think Jackson is probably going to spend most of the year in the twos, and that's fine.
Yeah, if we were saying that about development, there's nothing wrong with that. Small forwards. Cozzy didn't play. Bedford Spargo did. Who gets that call up for round one?
Tricky.
Well, these are the big questions.
Look, I think Cozzy has shown enough that he's probably going to take one of those spots. Is there going to be another one? Probably not when you factor in the key and medium-sized forwards. But got to say that pretty impressed with Bedford so far. I didn't see the game against North Melbourne. I understand Spargo was pretty good in the second half of that game, and certainly had a very good second half against the Hawks. So, look, we've got a few options, don't we?
We do. All right. So if Weed is injured, possibly injured, we don't know. We don't know the severity of it. We're going to talk about injuries in a second. If Weed doesn't play, we obviously need
does
a second
Jackson
ruck.
Play?
Does Jackson play in that scenario? Because Brown, they haven't been playing as a ruckman. They had an opportunity in the scratch match to play him in the ruck. He didn't play a second in the ruck, despite the fact that we only had Austin Bradkey and a Casey backup ruck. Does Jackson?
He adapted well in the ruck the other night. Was beaten early and then adjusted and did all right. I'm reluctant to play Jackson in round one over in Perth.
Yeah, they might be giving the Jack Watts treatment.
Not so much that, but he's still very slight. It's easy to knock him off the ball. That happens quite a bit in marking contests around the ground. So, I'd be looking for other options.
And what's the other option in that case? I guess T-Mac.
Well, we haven't seen Brown ruck, have we?
No, they did it. That's what I was saying. They didn't try him in the ruck. We didn't really have many.
Tomlinson's name has been bandied about.
But he hasn't rucked for a second either.
Haven't done that either. So, and then you're, so it's going to be interesting if Jackson does earn a call up in round one, that's for sure.
I guess the other question we'll just throw at you quickly before we move on. I was saying I really loved Lockhart's game. I think he's done enough to sort of get looked at, but we've got quite a number of options in the back line. With Salem coming back, does Lockhart, get a look in?
I haven't done my best 22, but if he's not in it, he'd be 23. Mm. And I'd be inclined to squeeze him in at this stage. I think I said last week that he showed plenty of glimpses last year and, he looks to have stepped up a few notches in the pre-season. Looks sort of pretty cool and calm with the ball, getting in the right positions. So ticking all the boxes at the moment, and wouldn't be surprised to see him in the round one team at all.
All right, we'll move on. We'll just quickly talk injuries. Unfortunately, we didn't get through this match unscathed. I didn't see the incident, but apparently Vandenberg sustained some contact to his foot in a contest. And almost nothing has been said about it except that I don't know. Did we get any official word that he's going to be undergoing scans?
No.
Okay.
Somebody caught the flight home.
Yep.
From Tassie with them, and he was apparently limping quite heavily or noticeably at the airport. I don't think he was in a moon boot, but look, the sirens start ringing as soon as you hear Vanders and foot in the same sentence. So
I'm assuming it's the same foot he's been having issues with.
Don't know. Yeah. I don't know that.
I mean,
George, do you know?
No, I know nothing whatsoever about it. That's been very quiet, we're trying to get Andy over his MST, so we might need to move on to something else. it was a real pity. I suspect Vandenberg was only going to play half a game in any case.
Yes, he was. We know that because he was going to be doing the running with Max at half time, and he couldn't do that.
We just have to wait and see on this one. The fortunate thing is we seem to have more bodies than what we need for holes in the team. So if we do lose Vanders, it's not what I much prefer him to be there, but if we do lose him, then we seem to have more than enough mids at the moment to be able to cover off. So that's a nice position to be in at this stage.
And look, the other thing is he hasn't really been part of the equation for the last 3 years. So it's not like everything's, you know, been sort of worked out to revolve around him. He's hardly played, so it's not like you're losing someone. We're just missing out on a possible gain.
He's got to be one of the most unluckiest footballers going around this side of Joel Smith at the moment, because can't get a trick. The Weed had a nasty, we talked about a nasty fall on his ankle. Hopefully it's just a rolled ankle. But to those of us who live under that black cloud of the veil of negativity known as the Melbourne Football Club Supporter Syndrome, commonly known to us as MFCSS, we should brace for the worst, I guess. And what do you make? I mean, nothing's been. The game was on Friday night, and we've heard nothing in regards to injuries. Where the guys have had, I'm sure they've had their scans. I'm sure we know the severity or whether they're fine or going to be right to go. And I guess, as supporters, what are we entitled to know? And I guess they need to. They don't want to give things away to the opposition. They want West Coast guessing what we're going to do. So with that in mind, as supporters, as stakeholders, are we entitled to know that? Should the club be more open about those type of things, or do we have to just, grin and bear it and sort of keep that information, in the hands of the Melbourne Football Club, for them in their war of information against, the opposition team?
Yeah, I don't think there's too much to be gained by, putting everything out there and sort of. I appreciate the need to keep supporters in the loop, but, there's so much conjecture around injuries anyway, and often it is a 4 to 6 situation, so there's not, oftentimes there isn't certainty about when the player's going to return, so. I think the club does its minimum duty in that regard. You get a weekly update, which isn't particularly precise and is filled with TBAs and TBCs and 4-2-6s. And I think that's, for the most part, supporters understand it and cop it, I guess, don't they?
And it's difficult with an injury like, say Wiedemann's with a twisted ankle. Well, he could well, if we had a game this week, he may well have been back. But the other possibility with a twisted ankle, as I said before, was, if he's torn ligaments, well, he could be out for 8 weeks. But it's so difficult. You can't. Most footballers, particularly as the season progresses, have some sort of niggling little injury, corkies, and this isn't working, that's a little bit strained, and so it's almost hard to write down everything because they may well be playing the very next week. At this stage in the season, I wouldn't be greatly worried about it. If it is going to turn into a longer term one, then I'm sure we'll find out about it. I think there's a training session coming up next week where we've got a few people, a few eyes on the outside of the fence. Will let us know where he is and what he's doing, and if he's not there, then we can all start to worry.
A Demon Lander also spied Toby Bedford at the airport on crutches, and I mean, no one saw any incident during the game, so I guess we can triple down on that MFCSS. Kid plays a decent half of footy, kicks a beautiful goal from the boundary, and next thing you know, he's on crutches. So how's that for MFCSS? I don't know. Look, I'm sure these guys have already had their scans and the club would know what's going on, and I hope it's not that mystery injury of the week that we find out on round one. That, but as
is,
you said,
is there a reason there isn't training this week, or is it closed sessions? Is it all?
According to the social media accounts of some of the players, they've been out and about, I think, at festivals and stuff, and so maybe they were given a few days off.
Coronavirus gathering.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so I don't know, maybe they'll give it a few days off and they'll start up again, so, you know, maybe later this week, because we're only, what are we, 10 days out? No, we're on the 22nd, 12 days out from our next game, 11 days tomorrow. So,
The other injuries, I think the ones that are realistic would be Smith and Hannon. Smith must be very close to being at full training, and Hannon, I suspect, would be in full training, but probably needs more time, given he hasn't done anything basically up until about 2 weeks ago. So our position isn't too bad, even with these suspected, you know, match injuries that we picked up in Tassie at this time of year. So we could actually have, you know, apart from the Nitschkes and the Collegiazneys, we might well have the full a full list almost available to play if we needed to coming 10 days away.
The Smith one is a funny one. Well, not quite funny. He hurt his foot. Did he step on glass or something?
Yeah, that's what we were told. Yeah.
So he had that. There was quite a period of time where he was in the rehab group, but he seemed to be running fine and doing things, yeah, but only kicking on his wrong side of his body. And then I don't know if you noticed last week, whenever they did the, they sort of had done an injury list or something to that effect, all of a sudden it's a quad injury. Mm. And I don't know where that came from, whether it was related to something totally different.
Because the initial thing was an infection, wasn't it? That,
yeah,
whatever wound he had got infected. So the infection has spread into his quad, which is concerning.
That's why I mentioned, I mean, he's had so many injuries. This guy just seems to get injury after injury, unlucky, which is unfortunate because, you know, we've seen that he is a good player and he just can't get onto the park. So it's upsetting.
Yeah.
I guess we'll move on. The To Hell and Back series is now over. We mentioned that the other week, we're very impressed with what we saw, very professional production. I thought the last week's episode, which was after the last time we've spoken, that was the Maroochydore one that was, you know, showing Max's almost season-ending injury. What have you thought for the last 2 weeks? I didn't love the, not that I didn't like the Maroochydore one, but I didn't think it was as powerful as the other ones. But I really enjoyed this week's one where they discussed where they had the captaincy vote. But one thing I would have liked to have seen was, and I don't know if it was too raw, but I would have liked them to have interviewed Viney about it. And maybe they did, and maybe they couldn't use it or didn't use it or for whatever reason, but I would have liked to have seen that emotion from him. I know it would be really hard for him, but I think that would have been a good thing to see. A Vin, yes. I was totally baffled by that. I've never heard him referred to as Vin. Maybe that's something we don't see behind closed doors, but that pulled me out of the moment for a sec.
Maybe the players really don't like Jack and he's being bullied and Vin is their playground nickname for him. Yeah, look, I'd think probably it's best to hold off on the Viney thing and the focus should be on Max. And
yeah.
Jack will tell his tale in good time and I suspect it'll be about round 16 this year. He'll be perhaps not leading but sitting on the leaderboards of the various media competitions and he'll sit down with the Sunday Herald Sun and talk about how disappointed he was at the time but how it's fueled him on and he's having his best season yet. So, Jack will bounce back from this disappointment and, if his pre-season form is any guide, then he is on track to have his best season if he can stay on the park.
George?
Yeah, look, the whole series has been fantastic. I think the last one, unfortunately, hasn't been as good as the previous ones. And when you saw Jack there, you really felt for him. If that was genuine and the first time they'd found about it, found out about losing the captaincy for someone who's been so committed and so dedicated, I was really sad to see him the way he reacted. Just as equally, I think it was telling when it looked like it was when they announced Harley Bunnell has been signed in with the group. I think that was fantastic to see the players' reaction to that sort of thing. It's been a great insight into what goes on. Hopefully it gives a few supporters some appreciation of the behind-the-scenes stuff and the amount of work and the amount of exercise and the sheer pain that the players go through to get up to round one to play for the side. It really has been a great series all round. So highly commend the club for what they've done, particularly after the horrors of 2018.
Yeah, I don't know if that Viney thing could have been the first time he found out about it. You wouldn't have thought they would have, don't you think they would have pulled him aside?
I think he would know before, but the disappointment was real regardless.
Oh, yeah.
Even if he did already know about it, having it announced in front of all your peers.
Yeah.
Look, it's tough for Jack, but he'll be fine.
I love the little bit at the beginning of the last episode where it was Nev and Cozzy, Nev taking him under his wing and, coming into his bedroom and waking him up and how he mentioned that, Cozzy was going to get up 5 minutes before he had to go and all that, and, Nev being the older head, trying to get him on the right path. I'd watch a reality TV series with the two of them living together. I think it'd be fantastic. But it's great having a guy like Nev there to sort of steer the younger guys, on the right path. Anything else from the Hell and Back series you guys want to bring up?
I think the only outstanding thing was Simon Goodwin needs to clean up his desktop,
yes,
according to some of our posters.
If it was me, my OCD doesn't like to see a disorganized desktop.
You're on your own there with a couple of them. So
That really puts me off. But particularly, I think he was on a Mac, and it's very easy to you can right click, and you can snap to this thing called snap to grid, which puts them all sort of just in line. And then I like to have it all sorted, folders and then alphabetical order and then files by type, and it was just all over the place for me, and I couldn't live like that.
I got to say, when I first saw those comments on Demon Land about the messy desktop, I didn't understand it because I was looking at his desk.
Yes.
And other than the computer, I couldn't see anything on it, so I guess I'm showing my age. Although there's not all that much difference between you and I, Andy, but
no, there's not.
Yeah, it took me a while to work out what you were referring to there.
Well, there you go. You're not even a boomer, so I can't even go okay, boomer, to you.
No. There you go.
All right, we'll move on from that fantastic series to Hell and Back.
It'll be interesting to see whether they've got additional footage and if the year did prove to be successful, as in the ultimate success, whether there's enough there for a doco and you'd have a proper to Hell and Back that perhaps takes in the whole year.
Well, I would hope that, because I think the filming definitely, whether it was an in-house production, and I'm not sure whether the post was in-house or out, whatever, but I would hope that they're filming throughout the year and maybe doing at least some interviews and stuff like that throughout the year, so that and maybe they should do that every year, because you never know what's going to happen if you have a great year and win the premiership. But I'd pay I don't know what to watch a doco produced like that. But look, there's obviously expenses involved with that, but I'd hope that they're filming throughout the year.
Interesting.
Getting sort of some of that raw emotion stuff. Coronavirus. Is there? We won't get into the politics of anything like that, but there's a possibility if they ban, and we don't know what's going to happen, but if things get worse There's that possibility. They've said that they'll play games without crowds there. And just I'll go back to my MFCSS. I can see us having a great year and me not being able to view any games live and us winning the premiership. Look, let's not get ahead of ourselves, but is not being able to go to the grand final and not being there and your team winning, is that going to feel the same as being there?
As long as they don't call the game off at three-quarter time when we're $6 or $7 up, I can manage it. But I think it's likely rather than it's a probability rather than a possibility that at least 1 or 2 weeks of games are going to be played without crowds. I don't think it's going to be sustained, and I don't think it's going to happen later in the season. It's likely to be at the front end of the season. But reading between the lines of the various health authorities and the AMA and Daniel Andrews and Gil McLaughlin's comments today, I'd say schools and footy is going to be closed sooner rather than later.
For round one, I'm quite happy if they cancel round one. Round two, no, because I want to go to it. But that can only help us in round one against West Coast without a crowd there.
The president of the West Australian chapter of the Australian Medical Association was quite tough today in saying that, you know, schools are going to close and this is going to happen, he was saying. So it could well be that our first round match is played in front of an empty stadium over there.
It's a difficult situation because we don't really know what's going on, and there's been so many different responses. Obviously, the first opportunity would have been to shut down the Grand Prix as far as Melbourne's concerned, and they're not doing that. The next opportunity will be what happens with the Olympics, and it doesn't look like they're going to shut it down for that reason. But apart from wanting to go and watch the team play, I think the big danger for Melbourne alone as a football club this year is that we've got the home games on the Queen's birthday and the Anzac Eve games. If we lose those two games, then, you know, as we saw last year financially, it's going to be a huge hit to the club individually. All the other clubs will be affected just as well, but in particular, you know, for us, if they were to shut down those two games alone, that puts us, you know, probably $5 million behind where we were last year, and that was bad enough. So it'll be a difficult one. I would hope that it doesn't happen, but gee, they've stopped watching soccer in Italy, or they've shut out the crowds for that. So if they can do that to Serie A against the mad Italians and their love of soccer, they may well find that they can do it in Australia as well.
But they're in a lot worse position at the moment,
yes.
Italy. And look, that could happen here. Go ahead, Gravani.
It's funny that you mentioned the soccer. I was watching the English Premier League on the weekend, and they've still got the crowds going, but they had a no handshake rule before the start of the game when the players line up on the pitch and everyone shakes each other's hands. And the commentator explained the edict not to shake hands, and then the cameras panned over to the bench, and as they always do, the two opposing managers embraced one another, basically hugging and whispering into each other's ears. So, the application or the implementation of it is interesting to watch from afar, I guess.
George, just going on what you said about the Queen's Birthday and Anzac Day. Well, Anzac Day is a lot sooner, but if I would say if they're still playing, if the crowds are forced to be, you know, to play, if we're forced to play in front of no crowds that deep into the year, then I think we've probably got bigger worries than a financial thing for the clubs. If it's still going on in a couple of months' time, where
No doubt it will be going on in a couple of. We're fortunate here in Australia; it's summertime at the moment, these viruses is spreading in the northern hemisphere in their winter. So come our winter, I think we'll see a dramatic increase in the spread, and then people have got to reevaluate what they're actually going to do about it. So we can only hope for the best at the moment, but I want to turn up every week and watch the team play.
Well, that's the question. If they are allowing you to go, will you be still going to the footy?
Yes. I noticed that Bitter But Optimistic posted on there that he brings more dangerous communicable diseases to the footy each week than coronavirus. So, I'll keep having faith in my fellow Victorians until such time as the health authorities advise otherwise.
Yeah, BBA's probably got immunity to all sorts of diseases, so he'll be right.
All right. Yep. Just a final thing that I've sort of got. The captains all met today. They all had their photos together. They also had a bit of a voting, not a voting, but they were asked a few questions about who they thought would make the top eight this year, which other clubs will reach the grand final, who they think will win the Brownlow and the Coleman and such. And Maxi, I don't know if it's a written rule or an unwritten rule that you're not supposed to vote for your own team. But when it got to the Coleman medal choices, Maxi went against that and nominated Bailey Fritsch as the player he thought would win the Coleman medal. Was Maxi just, was he just having, being Maxi, the lovable Larrikin, or is Fritchie a genuine chance? George?
I suppose he is in a way. If he plays 20 games, he could certainly finish up there. He's probably going to play more games than Lance Franklin and Ben Brown at the moment, given both of those are injured. So you never know. If he's just reliable and turns up every week, kicks two goals, well, all of a sudden you start to get into the top echelons of the Coleman medal. So he may well be right.
Maxi said on SEN today, I think he said throughout training this year, he's done some things that are pretty spectacular. Who does it from very little impact in the actual game? He'll have 5 touches, 5 marks, and 5 goals. He's kicked easily the most goals for us this little preseason bit, and he does it on Stephen May, and then he does it on Nev Jetta. So he's a pretty exciting player.
Mm.
So
you got to agree with all that.
Yeah,
he's got all the skills and the talent, Bailey Fritsch. So I think it's quite reasonable, perhaps not to win the Coleman, but that, as George says, he could finish right up there without too much fuss.
Maxi then doubled down and had Luke Jackson winning the NAB Rising Star. So there's Maxi for you.
Maybe he's trying to put a rocket up Weed and Tommy Mack.
Yeah, maybe.
I think, unfortunately for Jackson, he's not going to get enough games to win the Rising Star. I think Raoul's already got his name written all over that. He'll be playing from game one, and he probably will play 20 games for the Suns. So I think that's the more likely one over at this stage.
Boys, anything else you guys want to add before we wrap things up for this this podcast?
No, bring it on, I say.
Yeah, the only thing I noticed, Andy, is the membership numbers.
Oh, give us an update. I haven't been paying attention to that.
We're probably about 3,000 as of today below where we were at the end of this week last year. But we seem to have leveled the ship. We obviously haven't had the numbers come through post the game in Tasmania, so that's hopeful. But we're still ahead of where we were in 2018, so that in itself is hopeful. If we knock off the Eagles in Perth in the first round, I think we'll be right back to where we were very, very quickly. People will be back on board in a big way. So he's hoping for the best result in Western Australia.
Yeah, because if we can do that and then rock up at the G with all those people coming for the GWS game, hopefully they buy their memberships before the game. And then I think we've got a home game the next week. So if we can start the year off strong, look, GWS aren't going to be easy, but if we start the year off strong, maybe we can steady the ship, because I thought we'd be in a lot worse position than what you were suggesting. So that's good. Obviously we're going to lose people who were disappointed last year and probably bought memberships, you know, in order to sort of secure finals tickets, in 2019, and when that didn't eventuate, they're going to jump off ship. But if we can have some good results early, then maybe we will get them back.
Yeah.
All right, boys. So we've got a week. We've got 2 weeks before the start of the season. I don't think we won't be back next week for a show, but post that West Coast game, let's hope we're back here smiling again, and we're not ready to slash the wrist just yet. Thank you George, and thank you Grapeviney for coming in and joining us a bit later on. Thank you.
Pleasure to see you again soon.
Go Dees. We'll see you in 2 weeks, guys.